The US administration has submitted NASA's 2026 budget request to Congress, introducing major changes that will shape the future for space startups. This budget not only affects US companies, but also impacts international partnerships with agencies like the European Space Agency and JAXA, the Japanese Space Agency. In this video, we'll explore the key funding requests and their implications for space startups, breaking it down into clear sections. We'll start by examining the phase-out of NASA's legacy human exploration programs. Next, we'll assess the outlook for commercial space stations set to replace the International Space Station. Then we'll look at the commercial Moon and Mars program with a closer look at lunar projects, commercial Mars payloads, and human Mars exploration. The headline is a significant budget cut, slashing NASA's funding from $24.8 billion in financial year 2024 and 2025 to $18.8 billion in financial year 2026. Science programs bear the heaviest blow, with funding halved by nearly 50%. In contrast, exploration activities see a gradual increase as NASA winds down legacy programs and ramps up new initiatives, though these won't fully accelerate until 2028 due to the time required to close major programs. In summary, I'm optimistic about the new funding for commercial Mars activities, but concerned about the challenges facing commercial space stations. Reductions in small business grants will likely hit smaller startups hardest, particularly those with limited investor backing. One note before we dive into the details. Congress may not pass this budget as proposed. A continuing resolution, which extends prior funding levels, is a common outcome, so keep this in mind as we review the numbers. Phasing out of legacy human exploration program. Orion, Gateway Station, and the SLS launcher are all being defunded. These programs will continue receiving funding until 2028, as winding them down takes time. Artemis 2 and 3, critical missions to return humans to the moon before China's planned landing, will proceed as scheduled. Following Artemis 3, the crewed lunar mission, an orderly shutdown of the Gateway program, SLS, and Orion systems will happen. In their place, commercial heavy lift services will replace SLS, and the mission architecture will pivot to direct-to-surface lunar exploration, eliminating the need for an orbiting lunar station. Unfortunately, the continued funding of these legacy programs into 2028 delays funding for new lunar and Mars initiatives, which we'll explore later in this video. Startups specializing in crewed spacecraft, lunar landers, rovers, or prospecting equipment could secure contracts to provide these services, especially those with proven capabilities or low-cost designs for lunar missions. Commercial space stations. NASA continues to fund the International Space Station through 2030, but with reduced budgets, leading to fewer flights and astronauts on board. The plan is to wind down operations and only work on research related to human exploration under the Artemis program. Commercial space stations do receive an increase in funding, but it doesn't start to ramp up until 2029. Even then, the funding, which roughly doubles to around $600 million, seems insufficient to support multiple stations, or possibly even a single one, without additional contracts from other space agencies or private astronaut missions. This modest funding signals that commercial space stations rank low on NASA's priority list, potentially negatively affecting the development of a thriving commercial space economy in low Earth orbit. The problem with developing commercial space stations is NASA's exacting requirements, with all the money required front-loaded, while the funding from NASA only appears afterwards, if at all. This funding model doesn't appear to work, and I'd be surprised if there are many or any thriving commercial space stations with a current funding model. I'm happy to be wrong, we'll just have to wait and see. International partnerships could offer a lifeline. The European Space Agency may provide additional funding, leveraging its expertise in space station development. Thales Alenia Space, an Italian company with a track record in the International Space Station, Gateway, and Axiom Space's station, is a key player. Meanwhile, Airbus is a major partner in the Starlab commercial space station venture, bringing significant European involvement to the table. Now, let's shift to NASA's human exploration activities. Commercial Moon and Mars. The new US administration is keen on using a commercial approach for payload deliveries and human exploration of the Moon and Mars. From the budget document, we can see they are looking to commercially select missions for both human exploration and scientific objectives. NASA introduces a commercial Mars payload services program, modeled after the successful commercial lunar payload services initiative, which delivered landers like Firefly's Blue Ghost and multiple intuitive machine missions. The program targets its first commercial Mars launch in 2028, followed by a low-cost mission in 2030 with a $200 million budget, excluding launch costs. This opens opportunities for startups and established companies to develop low-cost Mars payloads and landers. Building on the successful Commercial Orbital Transportation Service, or COTS for short, which resulted in private commercial crewed mission to the International Space Station, the same model will be used for Mars. The agency will award competitive contracts to ensure good use of taxpayers' money. Various funding options will be considered, such as services for different phases of the mission, as well as end-to-end services. For example, we saw recently that Rocket Lab proposed an end-to-end service for the Mars sample return mission. The architecture used 100% Rocket Lab developed spacecraft, satellites, and launchers. Phase-specific services are great for smaller startups that can focus on niche capabilities like propulsion, communications, sensors, or equipment. Larger startups or established companies can propose end-to-end services, such as Rocket Lab's recent proposal for a fully integrated Mars sample return mission. Savings from using commercial systems will be reinvested in surface exploration and other capabilities that include advanced lunar exploration and accelerated Mars development. Work on a spacesuit appropriate for the Martian surface will begin soon, leveraging existing contracts. In practice, this means Axiom Space, as they are the only commercial company working on spacesuits for Artemis. Funding of lunar and Mars relay services is also included in the commercial Moon and Mars program. This will likely benefit companies like Intuitive Machines, already building lunar communication networks for NASA. The budget request aims for a near-term entry, descent, and landing demonstration for Mars of a human-class Mars lander. In practice, this will mean Starship, as no other company is close to building a human-class Mars lander. Perhaps Blue Origin will get involved, but considering the number of projects they are currently working on, I'm not so sure. Let's briefly look at some European systems that have been greenlit in this budget proposal. European contributions to the Artemis program. Both the Multipurpose Habitat, or MPH for short, and Argonaut, the European large lunar lander, will now be developed and built under the Artemis architecture beginning in financial year 2026. These systems will help surface logistics on the Moon. Multipurpose Habitat, Italian Space Agency. The Multipurpose Habitat, a cornerstone of the Artemis program, is a hybrid lunar habitat developed in partnership with the Italian Space Agency and the European Space Agency. Designed to support sustained crew operations, MPH enables extended lunar stays for up to 4 astronauts, supporting scientific research, extravehicular activities, and logistics. Its hybrid structure, combining a metallic airlock and an inflatable habitation module, offers durability and flexibility. The NASA budget proposal will accelerate funding for MPH development, positioning it as a critical asset for lunar exploration and a potential prototype for future Mars habitats. Argonaut, Large Lunar Lander, European Space Agency. Argonaut is a European large lunar lander developed by the European Space Agency as part of a strategy for human and robotic exploration. Designed for versatility, Argonaut can deliver cargo, rovers, scientific payloads, or infrastructure to the lunar surface, complementing NASA's Artemis program, or it can operate independently. It is a critical component of Europe's autonomous access to the Moon, enabling a significant role in lunar surface operations. Argonaut is capable of delivering up to 1,500 kilos of payload, equivalent to a camper van, including food, water, air, equipment, rovers, or power stations. It is designed to support crewed missions through the 14-day lunar night, where temperatures drop to minus 150 degrees Celsius or below. Both MPH and Argonaut exemplify the strength of international partnerships. Through a barter agreement, ESA and ASI, the Italian Space Agency, provide these systems in exchange for European astronaut seats on future NASA lunar missions, with potential opportunities for Mars missions. This partnership reduces NASA's burden of developing all lunar and Mars hardware, allowing the agency to focus on other critical systems. Moreover, MPH and Argonaut's designs hold promise for Martian applications, laying the groundwork for NASA's long-term exploration goals. By leveraging European expertise and commercial transportation savings, NASA strengthens the Artemis program while supporting a sustainable team approach to lunar and Martian exploration. Human exploration of Mars. NASA's financial year 2026 budget request allocates over $1 billion in new technology investments to enable crewed missions to Mars. This funding targets critical systems and capabilities to prepare for a sustainable Martian presence, using commercial partnerships where possible. The focus is on these key technologies: $200 million for a human-class Mars lander EDL test, $350 million for Mars tech development, $80 million for Mars communication relays, $50 million for Martian spacesuits, $120 million for robotic Mars missions, $80 million for space computers, surface communications and power systems, $200 million for commercial Mars payload deliveries, and $50 million for industry partnerships on human transport. Space technology funding. The space technology budget is $568.9 million, a reduction from $1.1 billion in financial year 2024 and 2025. However, $169 million is allocated for small business innovation research and small business technology transfer programs. These grants are critical for early-stage space startups, providing non-dilutive funding to develop high-risk, high-reward technologies aligned with NASA's priorities, such as Mars technology, lunar surface infrastructure, or advanced propulsion. Specific technology areas like space-to-surface access, surface infrastructure and exploration, and in-space infrastructure and discovery align with startup capabilities in robotics, autonomous systems, and in-situ resource utilization, offering opportunities for collaboration or contracts. Final thoughts. NASA's financial year 2026 budget emphasized commercial partnerships for Artemis and Mars missions, favoring established companies like SpaceX, Blue Origin, and Rocket Lab with proven track records. Startups with limited experience or funding may struggle to secure major contracts like crew transportation or space station development. However, startups focusing on lunar or Mars technologies, such as data relays, landers, in-situ resource utilization, or robotic systems, can win awards independently or within larger teams. Small business grants remain crucial for some startups, who should align proposals with NASA's lunar and Mars goals. Budget cuts could push startups to seek funding from international agencies like ESA and JAXA. Startups must prioritize cost-effectiveness to compete, offering low-cost solutions to survive despite challenges. What are your thoughts on the NASA budget? On balance, will it be good or bad for space startups? Leave your thoughts in the comments section below. Okay, that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.